So this next sessions, the next few sessions are about Weber Women in general and some other protocols. To open it up, we have Valdo here from Beam, who's going to talk about Atlantis Weber Women.
Because in Weber Weber also transaction should be bound. It means that you can mix transactions, you can add the output, but at the end you must present inputs and output at the same time. So we thought about using some what we call rounder solution. I mean, sort of a hybrid of the window with some other technology. So there are, I don't know, right now we use a modified addendum, which tries to, I think Rebellion does it too, which tries to make transaction on the way, also create a decoder output, but I call it as a component solution, because they fundamentally, they do not solve this problem. Now, there are also fundamental solutions, like using the KSNAP, but it's a whole other story. So, we decided to try to make a hybrid of Windows with Glantos. Now, Glantos is a work of around Jivan Yang, he's the core cryptographer. Now, all work is based on the public scientific paper. Now, Linatus is actually looks like a natural alignment of Mendel music. Because it's from the beginning to design the sort of an endom to make a sort of hybrid Linatus with pretty much anything else. And it's based on the same cryptographic assumption, I mean it's only the simple problem. And within the implementation of Linatus there are very similar constraints. So it looks like a very natural alignment. Now, Linatus itself is based on another protocol by cryptographer Ian Broad, which is called one of many signal protocol.
The microphone.
I'm sorry. Now, what is one out of my out of many signal protocol? Basically, you can look at it as a sort of a very sophisticated ring signature. There are many, many, many commitments or public keys, and I want to prove that I know one of them. So there is a ring signature, which is a pretty simple construct. Now, in contrast to this, the one out of n signal protocol by Nesrod, it has only logarithmic size, which makes it very, very, very practical for use with the large analytic state. Now, regarding the proving and verification time, well, they're nearly linear. So, for example, if we run one proof for an analysis set like 65,000, it takes pretty much time. It's about 1 second with a highly optimized code. But there are good things. One of which there is a huge benefit when you verify many proofs for the same analysis set, and it's also easily parallelized. So, I believe in such configuration, it's very useful in the box sense. Now, signal protocol is, well, I mean, what is the relation of the signal protocol to the anonymous transaction? Basically, it's used to prove that, for example, I want to spend some UTXO, I want to prove that I'm spending a valid UTXO that indeed exists without pointing out specifically which one I'm spending. So it's a base, but it's not enough, because in addition I also need to prove that I'm not double spending, I'm not spending twice, and also somehow I should prove that I'm using the historic value that was really deposited. So this is how it's done in the... designed by RAM in Linatus. So first of all, there are UTXOs in Linatus, as we remember, they also denote by Pedersen commitment. There is one addition, there is one more term by Green. There is one more scalar multiplied by one more nothing appreciative JR2 point. Now this additional thing is called serial number. Now I do this because later when you spend some output, you reveal it, you explicitly reveal it, and the rest of the protocol makes no use of this new generator. Because this, when you want to spend some UTXO, you're forced to reveal the core serial number, and then prove using the signal protocol that this output is valid. And this serial number, which you reveal specifically, it can't be used. So this is the cutting the double spend. So technically, it's not done in the following manner. Well, I'll skip some technical stuff. Let's assume that the serial number is just a real. And after it's a real, the verifier, it can calculate this part, this elliptical point, serial number multiplied by j, and subtract it from all the commitments in the anonymity set. After doing this, the problem is expected to provide a proof of knowledge of one of the commitments in the remaining set. So the modified signal protocol in terms of only two general points is used. Now, why is it modified? Because in this version by Ramzi Banya, he also made some modifications to prove there's a balance. Now, I'm not going to do the details because it's pretty complicated, but this is how he designed it. So, in the RAM transaction, you can spend several inputs, create several outputs, maybe regular outputs, maybe shielded ones, and then you should prove the transaction balance. I mean, for example, if you withdrew some UTXOs source from the shielded pool and put some more, you reveal the balance explicitly, and there is yet another proof, which the proof is expected to provide. Now, we took this as an idea, but we made several modifications. First of all, we didn't want to reveal the shielded value. So what we did is pretty easy. We did in a mingle-mingle way. So instead of revealing the value, we revealed a Pedersen commitment to this value. Now, after this, we decided to do this for each bin spent value. I mean, for each UTXO that I want to spend, we reveal its commitment, which commits to the same value, but with another blank pattern. And after we did this, we managed to redesign this protocol to actually get rid of the original balance proof. So we built a system that looks like, the idea is taken from the numbers, but actually, instead of making an abstraction, we just made it in terms of primitives. So we have a shielded output, UTXO, a shielded input, UTXO. Now we can also add a regular number of input and outputs, and we build one production from all this. So technically, what we get? In number of windows, there are three kinds of objects: input, outputs, and cameras. Now, input is usually just a Pedersen commitment to the UTXO being spent, and it should be present in the country UTXO set. Now, in case we want to spend a shielded UTXO, we also provide a spend proof. Now, for output, it can be either a regular mingle-mingle UTXO with regular range proof. If it's an Lambdas UTXO, then basically it's almost the same, it's just done with double bind proof. It's a little bit modified because this UTXO actually has two bind factors, the regular one and then the serial number. And the Russian kernel is also, so it's very similar to the regular Russian kernel. The only exception is that it's such as Russian, it can have access in both bind factors. I mean, regular mingle-mingle Russian, it can have access in only one bind factor, and it must be signed by the Schnorr signature. No, this kernel should be signed by a generalized Schnorr signature in terms of two generators, G and J. So the transaction may have access in both bind factors, but not the mingle. So, this is how our spend proof is implemented. So first of all, we reveal the commitment. So the commitment which will be used in the transaction. I mean, itself as a commitment, which commits to the same value, and that will be consumed by the other elements of the transaction. So we reveal the commitment, which will commit to the same value which we want to spend, but different by factor. Now we also reveal the serial number, as in the original data idea. But then what the proof does is the following: it subtracts the real commitment and the revealed serial number from all the commitments in the list, and then we use the signal protocol in terms of only one generator. So it means that the prover it must have revealed proper serial number and the value. Otherwise, it's not feasible to build such a proof in terms of only one generator. And by such we actually get rid of separate branch. what are the impact of Lepanto's? So the good thing is, of course, that it's built in red, which is built in red. There is also one nice addition is the one step penalty, because in classical number neighborhood, each transaction it must be created mutually, because if I can create a TXOR in number neighborhood, there's nothing can prevent me from spending it. Now in the Lepanto's it's a bit different. It's a bit different because in addition to know the same numbers, there is one more thing is, which I just skipped for simplicity. I must know some range for this number. Now, but there is also the price. First, there is obviously no cut through for the Lepanto's TXOR because there is no direct in because input is output. The verification and verification time is actually much higher. So, how it should be put all together? I think that the best thing is to build a hybrid system, which would consist of neural window production and the numbers. Now, most of the production, in my opinion, should remain neural window, because we don't really want to do the benefits of neural vision, which is less stability. Now, in addition, the number of shielded outputs, it should be somehow regulated, because if there are too many outputs, at the beginning I said that we basically want to hide in a big unlimited set in terms of its relative value. And for example, we want to hide within 65,000 outputs, but the question is how far those 65,000 outputs are being created. Because if they're created within just 1 hour, then it's not really a very good hiding. But if we define consensus rule in such a way that such an amount is created within several weeks, then it looks like a very good hiding. It allows very good in both the scalability and the anonymity. So I say the best strategy to mix the neural with the Lepanto's is like breaking it a bit between meaning forces. For example, if I do production with several people, I make a rush repeatedly, I can leave the role of the neural network. But if, for example, I want to interact with different people and I don't want someone to know all this, this is where I would like to break the repeatability. It's like having different accounts, transferring in the hidden way, find from one account to another, and then doing things from that account. Also, when you transfer funds through such a system, you must be patient. For example, after you create the output, don't spread immediately. You should wait for some time. Some reasonable time. So, but basically, it does mean that the linkability problem solved completely. Basically, hiding amount is practically pretty easy. But linkability is really hard problem. It's very hard to solve it completely. For example, in such a system, there are still sets. For example, dust attack. Attacker can create a lot of shielded outputs, so you can think that I'm hiding in a pretty big unlimited set, but in practice, many of those outputs can go to the attacker. So there should be some fees that would make such an attack feasible. Also, it would be not a good practice to mix UTXOs after you take some shielded pool with those which it did not, because you would, it's like taking clauses from boundary and drop clauses and putting it together. It's not good because you reveal the connection. I would like to also, because of all this hypothesis in there, I would also like to compare this to Monero. So Monero, basically, they use ring signature and the anonymity set is, if you compare them to classical number limo, what's good in Monero is that the energy set is guaranteed. The proof itself, it chooses the TXOR set in which it hides. But Monero, they do not solve this problem fundamentally. Now, the cache, in this effect, they're much better, because the energy set is unlimited. Now, but this does not mean that in practice, the solution, as of today, it's already good enough, in my opinion. Because in the cache, if you look at the blockchain, they have sort of several hundred outputs per day. So, for example, if you want to hide, as an attack, for example, if I'm an attacker, I can repeatedly make transaction with some person, And I can assume that this person spends outputs, let's say, from recent 1,000 outputs. So if I know that you're not getting enough, or because of some reason you can't wait long, let's say if you don't wait for at least 5 days, then I can also trade some. So in my opinion, for example, the caching education would be much better if all the transactions would be shielded. There are also other things, such as metadata leakage. For example, I can see how many GXOs you spend. For example, I can pay you with one GXO, I can pay you the same value with, I don't know, maybe some. And it's also that I can, by doing blockchain analysis, I can have it. So basically, I think, in general, backing leak is a hard problem. Because any user here, for example, if you know that you run some code, with some behavior which I can influence in some way, and I can measure this, then with enough experiment, I can statistically find it. The problem is, if this attack, it will be feasible in practice or not. Because, for example, if I can find you with 3, 4, 5 experiments, then it's easy. If I have to do 1,000 experiments, assuming exactly the same conditions, which is not basically true, then it will be to the hardware. But, I mean, bottom line is that no matter what technology is, you cannot just assume that I'm using a private coin, and I'm safe. It's not really true. Thank you. Which you mark, it's a student to GXO. It consists of a commitment and a double bind group proof. It's almost like a group proof, it's a little bit longer. So the node that receives it, becomes stored in the GXO, that it goes to the shielded output list. And later when you spend it, you say, this is my window, which is a match, I'm spending one of them without saying, this is the last one I'm spending.
Thank you very much, Paul.